Good morning, everyone. Welcome to First Congregational Church. We are people along the way learning, growing, and acting in faith. If you're joining First Congregational Church for the first time, welcome and good morning. Hello. We hope that we will be able to rejoin with you over the coming months as we transition into doing some gatherings in person in some ways. So keep paying attention to the daily update as those updates keep coming. The bulletin is on the website. In the middle of the homepage, there's a link at fccak.org. There are multiple responses and prayers that we will share together, and the hymns are printed in the bulletin as you would see them in the hymnal, and the words will also appear on the screen. There is, just in case you opened up the bulletin on the website sometime on Thursday, there was a version that was up for a few hours that did not include the baptism liturgy that we're going to share in a little while. If you're looking at a bulletin that does not include the baptism, you might want to re-download or reprint that if you'd like to follow along and share in the words with us. Speaking of that, today we did something that has rarely been done before, I'm guessing, where we shared in the baptism of Paul William Huser yesterday in front of the church with the beautiful flowers of the building behind us, and we're going to broadcast it today. So that's very different. It actually was very exciting. We were able to have about 20 people gathered outside to join Paul as he is welcomed into the care of Christ's church. There is a response that the congregation will share at that time, and there is a pause in the video, and that is when you can respond where you're at as the congregation, as we commit ourselves to our responsibility to those who join into Christ's church. Your microphone is now muted, and it will be throughout the service. However, if, especially during the prayer times, if there's something that you would like to share verbally and not just in the chat, feel free to let us know by typing the chat that you'd like to be unmuted, and we can definitely do that. Otherwise, during the prayer concerns, you are encouraged to type those in the chat. I know before the service started, I saw that there were, and I heard that there were a couple of prayer concerns that people mentioned. We will definitely mention those again during the time of prayer together. Feel free to turn your camera on and off as you see fit and whatever you would like. And as usual, if you run into technical difficulties, there's not much we can do in the moment. But if you have persistent problems, let me know or let the office know and we can try to address those. If your internet's slow or your computer's just not working very well, you can always join us by telephone, either using your cell phone or your home phone. And the instructions are in the bulletin or on the website, on the homepage. Today, after the service, we don't have any meetings to gather for, so we will, very shortly after the service, if you hang around, everybody will be randomly split into different gathering rooms, into breakout rooms. So sit tight after the service for our fellowship time together. However, this week, we do have a number of meetings, ministry meetings this week. They sometimes line up where they're all in one week. This is that month. So we have on Tuesday at 3:30 is stewardship. And just as a reminder, all of these use the gathering room link for the Zoom meetings. So 3:30 on Tuesday is stewardship. 4 p.m. on Wednesday is fellowship. And 6 p.m. on Thursday is worship. There's also afternoon tea at 3 p.m. on Wednesday and Friday. And then this next Sunday is council meeting, which will be immediately following the service around, you know, whenever we get finished. I think that's all the announcements I have for today. Make sure and check your bulletin for announcements. And as I said before, make sure and keep checking the daily update, because there's a, you know, things happen very quickly sometimes. So if you want to make sure and keep updated and know what's going on and how you can participate and things like that. So we try to communicate as soon and as effectively as possible, but, you know, it doesn't always work that way. Now let our service continue. If you would, join me as we share our responsive reading. It's from Psalm 119. Accept my offerings of praise, O Lord. I hold my life in my hand continually. The wicked have laid a snare for me. Your decrees are my heritage forever. They are the joy of my heart. And now join me as we share our baptism of Paul and then followed by the musical offering afterwards. Members and friends, we gather now to celebrate the sacrament of baptism. Baptism is an outward and visible sign of the presence of God among us and within us. Inasmuch as the promise of the gospel is not only to us but also to our children, baptism is the mark of their welcome into the care of Christ's church, a sign and seal of God's presence and the beginning of their growth into faith and discipleship. This is the water of baptism. Out of this water we rise with new life. Members of Christ's body, we welcome this family who baptized their child with us and among us. Parents Heather and Sean, with the help of your family and friends, do you desire to have your child baptized into the faith and family of God? Will you raise this child that he may become a disciple of Christ and member of Christ's church? Do you promise by the grace of God to be Christ's disciples, to follow in the ways of Jesus, to resist oppression and evil, and to show love and justice, and to witness to the work and word of the Holy Spirit as best you are able? God of new life, bless by your Holy Spirit this water. Save those who pass through it, professing that death does not have the final word. Continually create new life in the one baptized today, that he may rise with Christ. What is the child's name?
Paul William Hoser.
Step forward. Paul William Hoser, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Who as one is also many, and within whom we many are gathered as one. The Spirit of God be upon you, Paul, child of God, disciple of Christ, member of Christ's church. People of God, behold a new member of the body of Christ. People of the household of faith, I commend to your love and care Paul William Hoser, whom we recognize as under God's care. Will you endeavor to so live that he may grow in the knowledge that love of God has revealed through Christ by following your example?
With God's help, we will so order our lives after the example of Christ, that this child, surrounded by steadfast love, may be established in the faith and confirmed and strengthened in the ways of Christ taught.
Gracious God, you have filled the world with joy by giving us this gift of life. Bless now, Paul, your new creation. May he be filled with joy knowing your presence. May he be filled with wisdom and insight that he may walk in your way. Give Paul strength for life's journey, courage in time of suffering, the joy of faith, the freedom of love, and new life through Christ, who makes us all one. Amen. Welcome, Paul. You all can even applaud a little bit if you want.
Amen.
Thank you, Handbell Choir. A few years later, this has actually been pretty great to explore some of the recordings we have. I'm not sure who recorded that. My guess would be Lainey. I think it looks like where Lainey sits when she records. But we're able to revisit some of the music that we have shared in the past. Even before I was here. I can tell by a couple of the people who are there. So for our invitation to giving, just for some instructions, as I say every week, as people say every week, you can mail your offerings or pledge payments to the church, and we check the mail every most days. You can also drop by and put them in the mail slot, and you can also go to the top right corner of the church homepage where it says give, and you can give a one-time or a recurring gift or pledge payment there. But as you all and as we remember our baptism, we remember that we are born into God's care, that there is a connection through the sacrament of baptism to the body of Christ and to the care of God. But there is also a responsibility tied within that, that we will work and shape our lives of faith together in order to live into the way of Christ. So that's no different than what we do every week and every day at our jobs, at our homes, among our family and friends and strangers, that we are shaping our faith as we live it. And our giving together is no different. Please join me as we share our dedication of gifts. Gracious God, filled by your generosity to us, may we be generous to others. Accept from us these gifts of word and money as we commit our lives to you. Amen. Please join me as we share our time of prayer together. We come in silence, God, open to the way of Christ among us. And we rest, pacing our breath, in the midst of the Spirit with us. Ancient of Days, our beginnings and endings are with you. The force of creation abounds with your Spirit, and all things reflect your life into the universe. Upon us and among us in so many ways, you have breathed life and love. You move within our being. Work throughout our fellowship together and call us by name into this ancient holy work of creating and caring. Guide us in our triumphs and in our missteps, so that our work and play are forever pursuing after something good, after your way. For you are the source of our being, the light of all light, the love eternal. For this day and every next day, we pray in the name of the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please join me as we sing our first hymn, gather us in. It's number 284, and it's on page 6 and 7 of the bulletin, and also on your screen. The scripture reading today comes from Isaiah 55. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there until they have watered the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose, and succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy, and be led back in peace, and mountains and hills before you shall burst into song, and the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress. Instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle. And it shall be to the Lord for a memorial, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. My 2 weeks off were pretty wonderful. I caught enough halibut to last all year, and multiple very large rockfish, which are extremely delicious. I did nothing also for more than a couple days. To the many people who filled in and led services, though, over the last 2 weeks, it was great. I don't actually get to usually see the Sundays when I'm not here, when other people are preaching and leading. So this time I was able to watch as I prepared the videos for upload, and it was a very welcome task on my first day back from vacation to sit and watch you all worshiping over the last 2 weeks. One reason why it is so important for others to preach and to lead aspects of our worship is because different people have different things to say. I do not have the same experiences or frameworks of understanding as you. We all see the same readings. We all hear the same readings together on Sunday. Or we all experience events slightly differently and through different lenses. See, I'm pretty convinced that there is a limit to what each of us have to say in any given moment, and even in one given lifetime, about any given thing. That even goes for biblical writers. Isaiah, no less, is split into three parts by biblical scholars. Talk about how the time periods fit fairly comfortably into three parts. And they represent writings and thoughts from three different time periods, from before, during, and leaving exile. So it's like there was a person, Isaiah, who wrote the first part of Isaiah. And then subsequent authors in the tradition of Isaiah expanded for their own moment. See, the first Isaiah could not write about the experience during exile. And the third section, which is kind of a collection of oracles, could not speak to the pre-exile experience. And the second section, from chapters 40 to 55, it's speaking to people who are currently dealing with exile and displacement. So in the tradition of Isaiah, this author speaks to the people who are experiencing what the first Isaiah spent so much energy warning about. But even then, there is only so much that second Isaiah can even say about exile. Only so many ways he can try to help people understand the mess that they find themselves in, that the words fall short over and over again. Our reading today is only three verses, the last three verses of this second Isaiah. They are encouraging and liberating, especially for people who don't have much control over their existence away from their homes. But 2nd Isaiah doesn't start there. You see, it began with a firm realization of just how bad it had become, that the heavy impact of the experience of being exiled. See, what they couldn't see before exile is mournfully clear once it is upon them. A month or so ago, I recorded myself singing and playing a familiar hymn on the piano. It's the first time I've ever really played the piano much at all. But it's on the church's YouTube channel, and some of you may have seen it already. But I'm going to replay at least just the music of that video, because the words to that hymn are quoted directly from the very beginning of 2nd Isaiah. And these words create the setting for the whole section. And by the time this second Isaiah gets to chapter 55, the words of the prophet have come full circle in reliance and faithfulness of God. But along the way, have helped point the way out as people of God.
Speak to you.
And I'm not necessarily conflating the current moment as the equivalent of exile. But it is for sure displacement in countless ways. See, it's not easy to watch as our world unravels around us. And this may only be the beginning. We may still be in the first Isaiah moment that we have not even yet been displaced. And I imagine that people have always felt this way when the world is undone in real time. It rarely happens in an instant, but in spurts and in starts. See, currently children must go back to school, but how? But what are the impacts if they don't? Neither option is feasible. To not know what to do right now is to be normal. To feel torn from your foundations is to feel normal. I also imagine that the impact of the undoing is gradual. See, I most often think of the exile of the Hebrew people that Isaiah is talking about as sudden, because the story skips from the warning to when it happens. There's all this story in between that we don't get a glimpse of. See, I imagine that everything was normal until one day when they get the word that everyone packs up and they move. No doubt it would have been a shock to realize that today is the day when we have to leave our home. But the day before, for the soon-to-be exiles, had to have been an expectant day. I mean, I don't know what the next few months will hold, but I don't see stability and predictability as a common theme. See, Isaiah is speaking to a displaced people who have spent years trying to figure out what went wrong. What happened on the day when it all came to a sudden and abrupt stop? They ask the same questions we ask. How could a God who can do anything let this happen? There's a quote from Paul Hansen, who writes about this passage in Isaiah. He says that in spiritual life, as in personal, it is humbling to admit that the fault lies on our side of the relationship. It is comforting to blame others. So human beings invoke logic. If God possessed sufficient power and concern, Jerusalem would not have been destroyed by pagans, and we would not be exiles in a foreign land. At this point, he surmises, Second Isaiah seems to sigh. Confused and bewildered how the people could not see it coming, how they were surprised when the day finally came when exile hit. See, there must be a moment when we are deep within crisis and still digging deeper that we see clearly what our arrogance has created. In reflection, it becomes clear that it wasn't God or some grand conspiracy that tore us apart, but a persistent rationalization festering for years and decades, that we could never be the cause of our own demise. Yet here we are, confident and foolish in abundance. See, in doubling down on self-reliance as the way out when stubbornness got us here in the first place is probably not going to work. Realizing that we walked our way into this mess should tell us that we are going to need a way out that doesn't rely on our usual instincts as a people. And I am more confident as the days go on that we have not seen yet the full depths of our undoing as a people. See, I almost may have been too confident too early in the beginning of the pandemic that we would see an end that we would recognize. But the longer this goes on, the more sure I am that the way beyond this moment will not resemble much of what came before. Much like 1st Isaiah and 2nd Isaiah and 3rd Isaiah, they will take different voices and different lenses that cannot speak for the other moments, but can only speak to the one that we are in. And within that, I find a deep discomfort and a persistent hope that I am yet to fully appreciate. See, our world will likely never be quite the same, and I am terrified and joyful in a mix of measures that is confounding. And I know that many of you don't feel the same way. Some people don't. Some people don't see problems in the same way that I see them. And maybe you're correct. See, many of us have stable incomes and retirement accounts that remain stable. We have been fortunate as a congregation that most of us are still working and financially stable. But about a third of all house payments and rent payments were either missed or not paid in full so far in July. Exile does not just happen overnight. Displacement does not necessarily mean that we will be taken away to another place. It gathers and grows until the day when it becomes inevitable. And that is the moment Isaiah is reflecting upon. It's the exile of the people, the exile that they're in and have been in for some time, is in full view. The signs and signals that flashed beforehand are now crystal clear. The people should have seen it coming, but they didn't. And if they're being honest with themselves, they maybe did, but couldn't bear seeing it. Yet, and I say this with a resolute yet, the time of trial and struggle, however they come, whenever they come, are a reminder of what is important and true all along. This remains a rare opportunity. As I said in the first sermon, looking into this camera, this remains a rare opportunity to measure what we value and declare the resolve of our moral compass. This moment will require followers of Jesus to be who we say we are, to create the world we dream of as possible, and to see beyond the loss and turmoil of this moment and proclaim a new day will be dawning. The way forward is as sure as it always has been. It shows up like a baby being welcomed into our world. It shows up in the persistent welcome of life renewed through baptism. The words we spoke with and over Paul, our words that we can't make happen on our own, but they are words that we are assured and hope find their meaning. They are trusting words that God will be enough, that God will be who God said God will be, that the way of Jesus is sufficient for fullness of life, both today and every day, that the body of Christ is not forever bound by our own ability to make anything we say just so. See, finding our way out of exile, out of displacement, will require a fundamental revaluing of who we claim to be and who we say God is. It will take a resolute commitment that the word of God will in fact not return empty. What was worth fighting for was never ours to create or ours to lose. What was worth the effort was always right here, right now. It is in the proclamation that Paul is worth every ounce of God's care, even as he is yet to understand the full magnitude of what that means. Because you and I still don't fully get it. How do we understand that the word of God will not return until its promises have been fulfilled? See, maybe we are closer to Isaiah 40, the front end. Maybe we're not to Isaiah 55 yet. Comfort, comfort you, my people. And for sure, there is a need for the prophetic, corrective, communal, and personal reflection. But there will be a day when we look to a new way forward. Jerusalem was not the same place as it was when people left, and neither will it be so for us. That even Anchorage will not be the same place as it was before we all went inside. The time is coming, and it might be sooner than we think, that we will need to be reminded of such a promise. That God's word will not return empty. The way forward belongs to God. The way forward is found in the reminder of baptism as it claims yet another generation as living proof of the promise of God. Like the promise of rain as it falls, we will not return until its purpose has been met. Courage be to you who remember and proclaim your own baptism. May it be a reminder and a motivation in your life of the enduring promise of God's work. A work among us that will not return empty in this moment of exile and dislocation, but an enduring promise that the working of God in this moment will not return empty. Amen. Please join me for our closing hymn. It's number 22 in your hymnal, page 8, the bulletin, and on your screen.
Thank you.
we join together in our time of fellowship together and as you go about your day, we proclaim that our own baptism, that the baptism of Paul, will not return until it is finished. The sacraments that we share together and the words that we speak to one another create the world that we want to see. And they speak the way of God into being among us. And I am assured that the words of God will not return until they have completed their purpose. Go in peace. If you're still here, we will begin splitting into the breakout rooms. So sit tight for just a few seconds.